Okay, so let's go ahead and start to take a look at the slides from Chapter 3. And as we said in the introduction, we're going to be focusing on the preliminary stages of the audit, which is going to, of course, begin with client acceptance. And then we're going to get into some of the preliminary engagement activities, some very basic planning activities, such as staffing the assignment and determining some of our preliminary assessments of risk. And then we will begin to plan the audit, including, along with our preliminary assessments of risk, understanding something about our materiality. And that's going to be an area where we're actually going to look at some of the material from the text to help us along with that. As you go along and you try to look at some of your homework questions, I think what you're going to see is that if you can step back a little bit and understand what part of the audit you are on, what part of the engagement you're on, it's sometimes helpful to answer some of those questions. And I'll talk a little bit more about that when we talk about the homework. So let's go ahead and just take a look at looking at our prospective client and looking at some of our client's acceptance steps. And one of the key things that we're going to focus on is whether or not we should accept this client and management's integrity. We're going to see in some of the homework questions, the top reason not to accept a client is if the client lacks integrity. So we're going to inquire about the integrity of the client, the management, the board of directors, etc., to see if we should actually accept that client. And really, the number one reason not to accept a client is if the management lacks integrity. And you can think about what happened with Enron and Arthur Andersen. A client that lacks integrity could actually bring down the entire firm. Of course, the firm is going to need to be independent. This is the cornerstone of everything we do. And so we need to be careful that we don't have some sort of family maybe working for the client that would create a family impairance to our independence, or if there's another sort of relationship. We can't audit our own work, so we're going to see later some services that we cannot provide with the client contemporaneously with doing the audit. A number of issues could affect our independence, and of course we need to make sure that we don't have any of those impairances before we accept the client. We also will need to assess the firm's ability to properly service the client. And so it's one thing to take a good hard look at the client, which is something that we're going to be doing here, but we also need to make sure that the firm has the necessary technical skills and knowledge to successfully complete that engagement. And it's a little bit of a, ethical problem, professional responsibility problem, if we accept that client and get into the middle of the engagement and then decide that we don't have the technical competence. So it is a very key step to make sure not only that we're obviously following the auditing standards, but we're also following the professional responsibility requirements as well. We also would want to determine if acceptance of clients would violate any regulatory requirements. For example, if we're going to be utilizing, say, another auditor to audit a subsidiary of the client, and there's licensure requirements for a particular state, we'd want to be aware of those and make sure that we weren't having any problems with our acceptance under another state's regulatory requirements. And of course, just going back up to the top, obtain and review financial information of the client. If we have a client that is in a situation where they're experiencing some sort of financial problems, that could lead them to engage in financial reporting fraud. And of course, we just don't want to get involved in that, and so we would not accept that client. Now, not mentioned on the previous slide, just going over, there are required communications when you have a situation where you're accepting a client who had been audited by another CPA auditor prior to us becoming involved in considering accepting this engagement. That individual would be called the predecessor auditor, and if we are planning to take this client over, we would be considered the successor auditor. And there is a requirement that before engagement acceptance, that there be a communication between that previous auditor, the predecessor auditor, and the auditor that is contemplating taking over that engagement, and that auditor would be the successor auditor. Of course, they'd have to accept the engagement to be that, but they would be considered the successor. So what would happen? We say that an initial audit, okay, including if there's some sort of re-audit, is mandatory to make inquiries of the predecessor auditor. So we have to do that. There's no question that we need to make those inquiries. But then you take a look, and this has to happen again before engagement, but then you take a look and they tell us that the client permission is needed to talk to that successor. And bear with me, guys, while I get my pen going the way I wanted to here. And we say that client permission is needed in order to contact that predecessor auditor. So you just can't go and talk to the predecessor auditor without first getting the client permission. Now, that seems a little bit of a conflict. They're oxymoronic, I guess, if you're sitting there and saying, well, it's mandatory that I do this, but I have to ask for client permission. Well, look, there are some limited circumstances, and it's up to the auditor judgment, in which you may not have the required communications, but the auditor really needs to consider the implications. If it's because there's some sort of litigation going on and you get the feeling that the client is not the one that is going to be, the party that is seen as correct in that litigation, then you may not want to accept that client. But if it's reasonable as to why they don't want you to speak to the client, then you could skip these required communications, but you'd have to be pretty sure that there's something that is warranted to have not done these required communications. Okay, so for our purposes, we can just understand that these are mandatory communications and that the auditor is going to do these before, have these communications before accepting the client. And notice here the number one, and remember we said on the previous slide the main reason not to accept a client is if they lack integrity. So we're going to ask the predecessor about their views of management's integrity. Disagreements with management over accounting principles, auditing procedures, etc. So this is a important one, that we don't want a client that we can't get on the same page with regarding accounting principles. And auditing procedures, to me, is an even more of a concern, in that we're the auditors. We know what we have to do as professionals to satisfy ourselves that the financial statements are not materially misstated. And it gets problematic if you have a client that wants to try to not allow you to use your best judgment on these things. So we'd want to have that sort of a communication. Also, what is the predecessor's understanding for the reasons for the changes? Maybe we have a client that is an opinion shopper and that they didn't like something, they couldn't come to agreement with the predecessor, and their solution is just to fire the predecessor and hire somebody else that they think will maybe be more lenient. And if you're not those individuals, then we probably want to avoid this client. Also, if there have been communication by the predecessor regarding fraud, non-compliance with laws, regulations, etc., we obviously want to know about that. Now, we will also request management to authorize us to review the predecessor's audit documentation, their work paper. And I kind of stuck this one in down here separately because it is not one of the before acceptance inquiries, but it is something that we would ask to do. And if you've ever done one of these, it's sort of interesting. The predecessor brings the work papers, and somebody usually sits with you while you sit there and go through those and try to identify any key documents that are going to be significant to the engagement that you are now accepting. But that does not have to happen, again, before acceptance. These others, 1, 2, 3, 4, are communications that should happen before acceptance. So going over to the next slide, we remind ourselves that it is important to evaluate continuing clients, okay, for retention. Okay, just because a client was a good client last year or 5 years ago doesn't mean that they will then forever to be a good client. So we have to do that periodically. I would think you probably would almost want to do that annually to make sure that you're satisfied with that client and that you should continue that client. And at that point, now you're going to have direct knowledge about how accepting that client is of auditing and accounting procedures. And so you may want to think about it at that time and decide whether or not to accept that client. Disputes over fees. Again, if we are not getting paid appropriately by this client, we probably don't want to continue them. And at some point, if there's amount in arrears, it could actually affect our independence. So we certainly want timely payment, obviously. Taking a look over at the next slide, preliminary engagement activities. Again, guys, this word preliminary is pointing to us that we are very early on in this engagement. And we need to make sure that we have met our independence requirements. And this is, again, looking to see if there is any potential impairments to our independence for a family relationship. We need to look at if we have a client that has different subsidiaries, maybe if the firm has different offices, there's always a potential that some conflicts of independence may not be readily apparent to us, and so we need to be pretty vigilant in making sure that we don't have impairments to our independence. That goes on, obviously, at the beginning of the audit, but that really should go on throughout the year, throughout the engagement. For example, in my office, the GAO, the Government Accountability Office, we have to annually affirm our independence. We then have to do that at the start of each engagement, and then we do that throughout the engagement through the function of our time reporting. Each time we complete our time reports, we are asked to also confirm our independence. So pretty darn important, making sure that you maintain that independence. It is the cornerstone of everything we do. Okay, going over to the next slide now, we have to establish an understanding with the client. And when we say establish an understanding with the client, we are really doing this to make sure that there is no misinterpretation as to the responsibilities of the auditor, the responsibility of the client, okay? And so it is mandatory that we have an engagement letter on every engagement, and this engagement letter must be written, okay? There has to be a written engagement letter on every engagement that we get involved with our client. And basically, what we're going to lay out in there, and it's all about responsibilities to make sure that there's no misinterpretation as to the responsibility of one party or the other. And so we're going to have to make sure on the engagement that we have articulated in the engagement letter that we have articulated management's responsibility, the auditor's responsibility. We're going to make sure that they're aware of the limitations of the engagement. For example, we need to make sure that they understand that there's always a potential that there'll be a material misstatement that we will not identify. We need to make sure that they understand that we are not here being guarantors of the financial statements. In other words, they need to understand that there is a potential that there could be fraud that will not be detected. So we point out the limitations of the engagement, but we also need to point out the objective of the engagement, which is pretty obvious. We're going to give an opinion. And remember, we talked about the different types of opinion. We can have our unmodified, unqualified opinion. We could have a qualified adverse disclaimer. Of course, we wouldn't know at this point to call out the type of opinion, but certainly that our end product is to be an opinion. Okay, when we talk about, again, the limitations, we're going to point out that we're only there to give reasonable assurance. We don't give absolute assurance as well as another limitation. Okay, now, who signs the engagement letter? Well, let's just go ahead and take a look. And I actually took an excerpt from your text here, and it's kind of small, but it just doesn't have to be that big. I just sort of pasted it up here, where you notice that it is being signed by both the chair of the audit committee and obviously the auditor. And we're going to talk about requirements for boards of directors and audit committees in a little while. But just remember that it is signed by the audit committee. They are the ones that are responsible for hiring the auditors and making sure that the audit is going smoothly. So we ask them to sign that engagement letter. Going over, and this is sort of a flashcard that I have put together in the past that I thought would be useful for you for remembering things that are covered in the engagement letter. Next couple slides will have some of the key aspects. Management's responsibility, auditor's responsibility, since the major thrust of the engagement letter is to make sure that each knows their responsibility, or at least the responsibilities of each is articulated in this engagement letter, which is signed, so it is a contract. And you can see that I have this mnemonic over here on the side. Okay, I have this mnemonic on the side here, which is crisp porta, which means nothing. And I think maybe the only reason that it might be effective as a mnemonic is how stupid it is. But if you don't like it, you don't have to use it. But you do want to be aware of these key things that go under management's responsibility, auditor's responsibility. And some of these are pretty obligatory, guys, that management is responsible for the financial statements, internal controls, compliance with laws. We let management know that they must provide us a representation letter at the end of the engagement. We're going to talk about the engagement letter towards the end chapters. I think it might be literally the second to last chapter that we look at when we get along further. But in there, we're going to be talking about this representation letter, which is a required piece of documentation that we need to get at the end of the engagement. And in there, management accepts responsibility for, remember our assertions, completeness of information. They say that there's no misstatements in the assertions to us. If there have been issues regarding fraud, they have disclosed those to us. A lot of things that are sort of the auditor's nightmare, the things that are hard to audit, we want to make sure that management has articulated those to us. We've gotten complete information, etc. We'll see the representation letter later. Management has to sign this. Well, what if we got to the end of the engagement and management refused to sign this required piece of documentation? This would be very inefficient for the firm to go through the whole audit and then find out that we're going to have to disclaim an opinion, can't complete the audit correctly. So what we do is we inform management at the beginning of the engagement that they have a responsibility to provide us this representation letter, and we put that in the engagement letter at the beginning. So if they don't want to give it to us later, we can show them in this contract, remember they signed, that they had agreed to provide us this information. Okay, we're also going to make information, that management is going to make information available to us in a timely manner. If there are subsequent events, they will tell us about that. Subsequent events are events that happen after the balance sheet date. In some cases, they happen after the balance sheet date while we're trying to complete the audit. And we want to make sure that management has made us aware of all those, because those often need to be disclosed before we issue the financial statements. And so we'd want to make sure that we're aware of those. The world doesn't stop while we do the audit, right? And so if there are things that are subsequent events that need to be disclosed, the expectation is that management would have told us about those, and we put that in the engagement letter so they know that up front. Specialists, internal auditors, we're going to talk about the use of those later, but if there's entity staff that we are going to be using, we're going to, of course, want to let management know about that and have an agreement about that up front. And then, for the predecessor auditor, we need to speak to them in order to fully accept this engagement. Okay, so there are some things that are management's responsibility. Auditor is responsible for planning the engagement and performing the engagement, of course. Obligations to provide documentation to other parties. If there are component auditors, that are involved in auditing components of the entity, then there's an expectation that we will provide that. Well, actually, in that situation, we're providing the information. We would be the component auditors, and we would provide information to those group auditors. The group auditor being the one auditing the consolidation. We're auditing a subsidiary. We're a component auditor. Obviously, we need to provide information to the auditors that are in the consolidated statements, and so we would make sure we cover in that engagement letter that we are providing them that information. If there are restrictions on our liability, we would disclose that in this engagement letter. And then arrangements regarding the composition of the engagement team. And then the form and content of our audit report, talking about, again, we're not in a position to tell them whether we're going to be giving an unmodified, unqualified opinion at this point. But we certainly would be letting them know what the form of the report is going to be at this point. So just some things to help you remember what goes into the engagement letter. Must be signed, comes at the beginning of the engagement. Going over a couple of true or false flashcards for you. Audit fees and cost should not be discussed in the engagement letter. That's obviously false. Okay, this is the contract where we are going to want to talk about fees, recovery of cost that the client will bear. Those things need to be clearly articulated. And we've already said this, you know the answer to this one. There must be a written engagement letter on all engagements. And so that's, of course, true. Okay, so just to help you remember some of the key aspects here. Going over to the next slide and just taking a look at this is actually an old CPA question that asked about which of the following matters is generally included in the audit engagement, and what we saw, and that was sort of the basic one, management's responsibility for the fair presentation of financial statements. These other things we don't put in an engagement letter. Some of these things aren't even true. I mean, we don't have responsibility in D to search for significant internal control deficiencies. We will understand the internal control. We will evaluate the internal control to help us complete the audit, but we do not have to search for control deficiencies. So a couple of these are things that we do, but we don't put them in the engagement letter. D, we don't do. B and C, we might do these things, but and we would do B, definitely. C, you know, this might be true. I don't know. Maybe management has a vicarious liability for violations of law committed by their employees if they weren't diligent in making sure their employees were in compliance with laws, but we're not putting that in the engagement letter, okay? All right, great. So let's go ahead then, and let's look at the next slide now. And again, some of the things that we see here that we've already understood, but I just want to point out that we're transitioning now over to discussion of some of the things that we're now communicating in the engagement letter, specifically here what some of our involvements are going to be, and we'll go into this a little bit later. I just want you to realize that later we're going to go into the discussion of specialist and internal auditors. Okay, so let's go ahead and let's take a look now at that internal audit function that we saw, that we called that out in the engagement letter. And you can see that when we are considered using the company internal auditors. Now, just to make clear, we're talking about the internal auditors. These are individuals that work for the company that perform an audit function. They often will go in and look at the internal controls of the company and provide recommendations for improvement in the controls. And we're going to learn that the external auditor, that's who we are, the CPA, the external auditor who's coming in, the CPA who's coming in from the outside, will want to look to those internal auditors who could have detailed knowledge as to the functioning of the internal control. And they're sort of brethren auditors, so they understand a little bit more what we're trying to do. But it's important that we realize that even though we will be assessing their objectivity, and they are to maintain their objectivity, they are still employed by the client. So they are not independent. They are not independent. They have objectivity, but they are not independent. Therefore, when we think about objectivity, it's important to remember, do not share, judgments. Do not share judgments with the internal auditors. I'm just going to put them down as IA. Do not share judgments with the internal auditors, okay? Don't do that. And it's kind of hard because, you know, you're used to being told ever since you were a kid to share things, you know, but not our judgments. So if we're looking and it's our responsibility to make an assessment of risk, we don't turn to the internal auditors and say, well, you make that assessment, you know the company better than us. No, we can't do that because they are not independent. But they do have to maintain their independence, and we also are going to assess their objectivity. Okay, so we're going to look at their, we're going to have to assess their competence. And their competence is making sure they have the appropriate knowledge, education. Look, if they're CPAs or certified internal auditors, that's going to go a long way towards helping us assess their objectivity. Now, when we, their competence. Now, when we look to their objectivity now, okay, when we look to their objectivity, we're going to want to determine to what level of the organization they report to. So, if I have my board of directors sitting here, and I will have my audit committee, we'll talk more about this, but audit committee is the part of the board of directors that is responsible for the audit, etc., and the board of directors sitting here, and we should have a situation where our internal auditors report directly to that board of directors. That's the type of objectivity that we're hoping for, that we're expecting. I shouldn't say we're hoping for. We're expecting to see when we are looking at the objectivity of those internal auditors. And if we see that direct line of communication, then we're going to get a little bit more comfortable with the objectivity of those internal auditors, because we can utilize them. But again, remember, we do not share judgments with the internal auditors. Now, if we are talking about a public company, PCAOB, remember the Public Company Accounting Oversight Board that we talked about in Chapter 2, PCAOB requires, okay, this is a requirement, requires that there be an audit committee that oversees the internal auditors. So that's something that is required under PCAOB. And homework question number 11, of course, if it's PCAOB, it's public companies, but homework question number 11 tests you on that, remind you of that point. Okay, all right, good. So let's take a look at this question, and this question talks about which of the following judgments may independent auditors share responsibility. Don't share your judgments. You are responsible for judgments for things like assessment of inherent risk, control risk, which we'll talk about in more detail in some later chapters. But again, these are judgments. You do not share your judgments. Okay, so we were talking about the audit committee there a little while ago, and their responsibility to oversee the internal auditors. But let's just make sure we understand a little bit more about that audit committee now, going over to the next slide here. And as we've already stated, the audit committee is part of the board of directors, and Sarbanes-Oxley. Remember, we have Sarbanes-Oxley, Sarbanes, the Senator Oxley, the House member after Enron, etc. They established the Sarbanes-Oxley Act to try to rein in some of the problems that were going on back in 2002. And they say that they are directly responsible for overseeing the audit of the public companies. So they're really overseeing, and by that, it doesn't mean that they're directing our work. It means that if there are concerns, issues that we have, those are to be communicated to the Internal Audit Committee, and we would expect them to help to resolve those issues. Okay, we must also see that the audit committee must also approve all services that are provided by the auditor, including non-audit services. So if we're going to be providing tax work, that's something that should be signed off on by the internal auditor. So we need to make, not the internal auditors, by the audit committee. Going over to the next slide, we would then come up with an overall audit strategy, and that would include developing our audit plan. And when we develop our audit plan must be written. Okay, we must have a written audit plan. So that audit plan has to be written, okay? And it's going to articulate our strategy and really get pretty detailed. That says must be written. It's going to be pretty detailed as to what we're going to be doing on this engagement, and that is important because I don't know that these guys need to be on their knees, but we're going to be informing our audit team as to what it is that their responsibilities are, where we're going to be auditing, what our time frames are, etc. So it includes obviously making sure we're effective, but also making sure that we are going to be efficient in how we complete this audit. Going over to the next page, we will start to assess some of the business risks associated with this client, and we're thinking that by obtaining that understanding of the entity and its business, and notice, guys, we could do this after we've already accepted the engagement, but we would have to be able to have the ability to appropriately acquire that knowledge. We will do this to identify the potential for parts of the financial statements operations of the entity that are going to be susceptible to, and this guy's really trying to focus his resources on the errors here, and we do this to make sure that we are providing more resources for the more risky accounts and disclosures of the financial statements. So that is why we would understand the business, so that we can assess those kinds of risk. And we're going to get into detail as to assessing risk in not the detail, but more the thought process is probably a better description of what we're going to look at here in a little while about under the assessment of risks. Obviously, if we're dealing with consolidated financial statements, we're going to focus our attention on the areas of higher risk. If there are a few different subsidiaries, then obviously those that are more risky are going to be looked at more closely, and we'll have more audit resources applied to those. That could be a materiality consideration. By that meaning, larger subsidiaries would receive more attention, and that's sort of obvious common sense. But there could be a smaller subsidiary that has larger risk of misstatements, and if that's the case, we would allocate more resources than their mere size would indicate. Taking a look at the next slide, assessing the need for specialists. No, we maybe could have put this up with the internal auditors discussion. It is a similar logic as we go and look at both the competence and objectivity of the specialist. Now, why do we need to consider specialists? Let me give you an example. I was on an audit of U.S. Forest Service, and on that audit, The Forest Service reports the value of the forest in terms of the board feet of lumber that are contained in that forest. Now think about that. I'm an auditor. I'm from Hayward, California. I'm from a, you know, suburb to a city, although some people don't think Hayward's a city, but it is. Okay. And what do I know about board feet of lumber that are in a forest? Or even if I grew up in a foresting area, I may not know that, right? Or lumber town, or whatever they call those. I wouldn't know. And so what happens? I would call in, and we looked at what the silviculturist determined was the board feet of lumber in that forest, and we relied on their estimate to determine whether or not the financial statements were materially misstated. So when you're looking at that, you're saying, well, okay, I need to determine the need for a specialist. I need to determine their competence. So we would, of course, look to see that they had the appropriate certifications, etc. But what about their objectivity? What the auditing standard board allows for us in this situation is to use a specialist that is related, employed by the client. It does not have to be an independent specialist. And they do this because they understand you could be in the middle of a forest somewhere, and the only specialist that's close to you is the one that's actually on the premises. So you can use a specialist that is related to the client, but you need to take careful consideration, obviously, of their objectivity there. I'm not sure what all this is, but it looks like a highly technical process and why you would need the specialist. And you could have a situation where your client is so unique that only their specialist can give you that level of reliability. So it's okay to use the specialist that's related to the client, but make sure you are very diligent about considering their competence. Well, competence, of course, but their objectivity. Going over to the next slide, we need to consider the potential for illegal acts, violation of law, okay? And illegal acts are a little bit different than fraud in that a client could potentially accidentally not comply with the law, right? It can happen, but it could be intentional, could be unintentional. Now, if the illegal act is going to have a material and, a direct, I want to be over here first, direct and material effect on the financial statements, there's a consideration that the auditor will identify that. There's an expectation that the auditor will identify that as part of their audit. And so we consider considering those laws that have a direct and material, we consider that as part of the audit. We need to take some specific steps around that. For example, making sure that the client has filed their tax returns. Okay, now when I say making sure that they filed the tax returns, you're not just looking at the tax returns to see if they filed them, but what? When you were looking at their income tax liability, if you're looking at their tax expense for the period, current and deferred, there would be an expectation the best source of that information would be the tax returns. And if you asked for the returns and they said they haven't filed them, you now have found an illegal act, a violation of law, and the standards are expecting that that's right in the wheelhouse of the audit, and that that should be part of the audit and something that you should identify. Now, there could be material and indirect, and for these, the auditor needs to be aware of what might have occurred and investigate if brought to the attention, and that if's doing a lot of important lifting for us there, right? So it almost means that it's not expected that we would necessarily identify these, but if they came to our attention, we would have to do something about it. To me, an example here might be, let's say you're auditing a trucking company, and there are obvious occupational safety issues that should be being considered. It's not the responsibility of the auditor to go out and check to make sure that every, forklift is properly maintained. But if there were some issues there that were brought to your attention, then you would investigate them. Here, the expectation is if you're doing this audit correctly, you should identify this one. Here, it really depends more if something came to your attention and you don't have to go around checking every potential law and seeing that they're in compliance with it. Taking a look over at the next slide and circumstances that might indicate an illegal act, and if you see that there is a government agency investigating the company, that's something that might make you say, maybe there's an illegal act that's gone on, or if they paid some sort of unusual fine. Up here again, fines or penalties, failure to file the tax return, there you go. I mean, they're calling that out as something that would be pretty indicative that there's been an illegal act, and you certainly would want to get behind that. Okay, going over to the next slide, related parties and what happens here. There is a requirement that if the entity has a transaction with a related party, those are to be disclosed. Now, what are related parties? Affiliates of the client. For example, their subsidiaries. They have transactions there. That needs to be properly disclosed. Could be that they've had a transaction with management. Maybe they've loaned money to management. Maybe they've borrowed money from management or their immediate families. There is no prohibition to having these related party transactions. However, they have to be properly disclosed. How can we identify those related parties? That's not something that's easy for the auditor to do, because the auditor is not necessarily aware of every single related party. So some ways to identify related parties is given to us over here, and we can review board minutes. Okay, if there was a conflict of interest statement that was provided, that should be provided. You can see some of these significant unusual transactions that differ from the market terms, a loan that is below market rates, etc. Okay, so what happens? You come over other ways, okay, to identify. So let's just go ahead. Other ways to identify is what I want to put down here. Other ways, SEC filings. They need to file with the SEC, disclosing who their affiliates are. So SEC filings might also be a way to identify. And again, if there's guarantees, okay, guarantees of loans, etc. Okay, that would be something. Again, loans below market rate. Can you just put that in? Okay, just to talk about a couple of things that could be indicative of related parties. And once we do these to get a good list of related parties. And the best way is to inquire of management. I can't believe I'm leaving that one out. We literally will ask them for a list of the related parties and just ask them to provide us that listing. Okay, so by these steps now we've identified what the related parties are, and what we would do is just provide our staff with a listing of the related parties, and then it's not like we have to select specific transactions for related party testing. We would simply then, with this list and with this procedures that we did to identify the related parties, have a listing of related parties, and when staff or are looking at a transaction that has maybe a different objective, a different assertion that's being tested, at the same time we could check them against the related party listing and see if there's any disclosures that would need to be made. Okay, then you come over and you take a look at this next slide, and we talk about, you know, additional value-added services that could be provided, such as system design, helping them with their design of their systems, also tax planning. Okay, now notice down here that something that Sarbanes did is they call out that there are some services that you cannot provide contemporaneously with the audit. And they're doing this to help us to avoid conflict of interest where we are essentially auditing our own work. Okay? So, what happens? Tax work contemporaneously with the audit of the financial statements is okay. System design, not okay. Okay, what's happening? If we're helping them to design their financial reporting system, and then we have to come in behind and take a look at that that internal control system, and if we're with a public company, even provide assurances on that, we have violated some of the Sarbanes requirements, and we would not want to provide that service contemporaneously with the audit. Okay, going over to the next slide, supervision of our audit team. This is something that is done, and when we look at this, you know, it's important that we understand that, yes, the partner is supervising the team, but then there's also other supervisors, such as your seniors, that are going to be supervising, and that goes on at all levels. And of course, we have to inform the team of their responsibilities, okay? Direct engagement team members to identify and communicate audit issues and review the work of the engagement team members. Now, when we conduct our supervision, it is not a one-size-fits-all, right? The more difficult the task, the more supervision that we would expect, the experience of the staff would require more or less supervision depending on their level of their experience. Okay, good. Come over and let's take a look at this next slide. And this is a pretty important slide. Okay. When I look at this slide, I see steps in the audit process. Okay. I see two basic steps, or major steps, maybe is a better way to put it. I see step one being the risk assessment procedures, and then I see this part down here being further audit procedures. Okay, these are going to be my further audit procedures. These two boxes down here are further audit procedures, and I see that as being step two. Okay, and I'm going to put audit procedures, further audit procedures. Easy for me to write. Okay, sorry guys, it's a little sloppy. But that says further audit procedures, and that's going to be step two. Further audit procedures is step two. And we're going to see that step one is always done on every audit. We must do step one. So you can just put always there. That's done on every audit. And in this phase of the audit, we obtain an understanding of the entity and its environment, including its internal control, and we do that to make assessment of risk. You think, since it's risk assessment procedures, we will make an assessment, and the assessment that we're going to make is something called the risk of material misstatement, that I'm going to abbreviate RMM. So we always do that on every audit. Now, what we learn from this step determines what we do in step two. Okay, and the standards don't necessarily call this step one, step two. I'm doing this just so you understand that you go ahead and you do the risk assessment procedures, and that determines what you do in step two. And in step two, if we have assessed the risk of material misstatement at less than the maximum, then we will go ahead and test the controls. Now, I have a little disagreement with this slide. I think that the way the authors of the textbook put this together, they're saying that we will look at the effectiveness of the controls here, which I agree with that. We look at operating effectiveness here. Design of the control really should have been evaluated up here. And think about that. If you're trying to make an assessment of the risk of material misstatement by looking at the internal control, that would have been a time to evaluate the design of the controls. So I think looking at the design of the controls really should have been done up there rather than call it out down here as a test of controls. Now, we only test the internal controls if we have determined that the risk of material misstatement is not at the maximum. So this is a sometimes. If the assessment of risk of material misstatement is exceeding, you know, at or exceeding, I don't know how it could exceed the maximum, at maximum, then what? Then we will go directly to our substantive testing. And we do this always. And substantive testing is done to detect misstatements in our financial statement assertions. And remember, when we talked about the assertions, could be at the transaction level, account balance level, or disclosure level, but we are going to be looking for misstatement in the financial statement assertions, we call that substantive testing. Okay, substantive procedures, and we do that work regardless. On every engagement, we have to do substantive procedures, and those are designed to identify misstatements in the assertions. And everything we do in some of these upcoming chapters is going to be designed around the assertions, and I'm going to keep pointing that out because I think that when you're first getting into understanding auditing, you're thinking, okay, I have to do this procedure, I have to do that procedure, but it's important for you to realize that these procedures, and we always have to do substantive procedures, are going to be there to help us detect misstatement around the assertions. Now, this is one way to look at this. Okay, so let's go ahead and let's take a look at this slide that I have that has put this to me in more the step process. This is step one, and we're going to see the step two information that we were just looking at on the next slide. But notice we say here risk assessment procedures always have to be performed, just the way we saw on the previous slide. I have added in here that this can also be called obtaining the understanding phase, okay? And there are some key words that we want to be aware of. I've given you a mnemonic for that, DIRE. I know that's not how you spell DIRE, but I'm spelling it that way there so that you pick up some key words. Now, notice we say that we have to understand the entity's environment, but we need to also understand the internal control, and we will evaluate the design of the controls and determine that they have been implemented. These are two key words. Design of the control means, is the control designed appropriately to allow for to prevent or detect a material misstatement in the financial statements. So we want to see if there's a properly designed control, but I could design a control perfectly, and if I don't implement it, then it's not going to prevent or detect the misstatement in the financial statements. I could implement a control, and if it's not designed well, then it will not prevent or detect a misstatement in the financial statements. So the auditor evaluates the design, the implementation, and based on what they learn from that step, if they don't like the design, or they have a well-designed control, they don't like the implementation, then the auditor would assess the risk of material misstatement at the maximum. If the auditor assessed the risk of material misstatement because they are satisfied with the design implementation at less than the maximum, then they would go ahead and proceed to test the operating effectiveness of those controls. So, we don't like the design, and or we don't like the implementation, we would assess the risk of material misstatement, and that's the A and the R in DIRE. You always have to make that assessment of risk. We're in the risk assessment procedures. We would go ahead and make that assessment of risk, and we assess that risk of material misstatement, which is abbreviated RMM, at the maximum. We're going to bypass the testing of operating effectiveness, another key phrase, and go directly to substantive testing. And you're going to see a red arrow on the next page. It's going to point to that. If we assess the risk of material misstatement at less than the maximum, medium or low, Then we will first test operating effectiveness controls, and then, and we always have to do our substantive testing. So you go over to the next slide. You can see our arrows are not quite pointing where we want them to, but we'll be okay with that. Now we're in step two. Remember we said a couple slides back that step two was called further audit procedures. It could also be called the test of details. So we have obtaining an understanding phase, a test of details phase, and if we have assessed that risk of material misstatement, which is what we do in step one, at less than the maximum, then we would first test the operating effectiveness of the controls. Now notice I say sometimes, because we would have had to assess the risk of material misstatement at less than the maximum in this case. If we have assessed the risk of material misstatement at the less than the maximum, we would first test the operating effectiveness, and then we would go ahead and do our substantive testing, and it would depend, the nature, extent, and timing of our substantive procedures would depend on how well our testing of the operating effectiveness of the controls went. If our the operating effectiveness is reliable, then we would not have to do as much extensive substantive testing. If the controls were considered based on testing of operating effectiveness to be less effective, then we would go ahead and expand the scope of our substantive testing. Now that's in the case where in step one we had assessed the risk of material misstatement at less than the maximum. Remember we said from the previous slide, if we had assessed the risk of material misstatement at the maximum, then we would have gone directly to our substantive testing, and I kind of wanted the arrow to point up there. We would have gone directly to our substantive testing. In other words, we would have bypassed the testing of operating effectiveness, gone straight to our substantive testing, and then expanded the scope of our substantive testing accordingly, because we did not see controls in which we were satisfied with the design or the implementation in step one. So, again, two steps to this process, and by the way, these steps, the way it's laid out, you're not going to see that in the text. This is the way I like to describe the controls, but two steps, the process, I should say, two steps in this process. Step one is to do our risk assessment procedures. Always have to do those. We look at the design of the controls. We look at the implementation. We make an assessment of risk. In other words, we assess our risk of material misstatement. The outcome of what we do in step two is determined by step one. If we had assessed the risk of material misstatement at less than the maximum, we would first test the operating effectiveness of the controls to determine what the timing, extent, and nature of our substantive procedures are going to be. We always have to do some substantive procedures, even in that case. If in step one we had assessed the risk of material misstatement at maximum, then we would have bypassed the testing of operating effectiveness and we would go directly to our substantive testing represented by this red arrow, and we always have to do that. When we test our controls, and remember guys, we do this sometimes, only if we had assessed the risk of material misstatement at less than the maximum, there is a set of test of controls, or I should say a categorization of test of controls here that we would do. For example, we could re-perform the control. We're really putting ourselves in the seat of management and employees and seeing if we think that control is effective for preventing or detecting the misstatement. Remember, we're testing operating effectiveness of the controls here. We're testing controls, observation, watching the management or the employees, probably more likely, actually executing that control. Inspection is just looking at documents to see if the control was applied, or looking at, it doesn't have to be documents, but looking at evidence is a better way to describe that, to see if the control was applied. So if supervisors sign off on a time card, we're looking for that sign off. Okay, we don't have to sit there and watch the supervisor sign every single control, sign every time card, which is what would happen for observation, but we might want to inspect those time cards. And then inquiry. Okay, we're going to have to inquire about the design, the implementation of the controls, and inquiry alone is not sufficient to allow us to make an assessment of risk in the material misstatement, support our testing of operating effectiveness. We would have to combine it with some of these others. But this is a hierarchical list. Okay, the best test is 1. 2 is considered the second best. 3 is considered there. And 4 is the least reliable test of controls you can do. And you have to combine it with one of these others on the higher end of this chart. The text. Okay, so you take a look at the next slide here, and you can see that we are again, although not in a hierarchical setup, calling out the different types of tested controls. I want to point out that the text has included walkthrough here as a test of control. I would think of a walkthrough as really being more meaningful to me in the obtaining the understanding phase. Okay, so even though you're talking about walkthrough here, I think that in our step 1, when we're doing our risk assessment procedures, we'd want to walk a transaction through from its initiation to its recording in the financial statements, and to me that is an invaluable step in allowing me to obtain the understanding and look at the design of the control and the implementation of the control to see if I think it has a chance of having operating effectiveness to be tested in step 2, when we would sometimes test our internal controls through doing our re-performance, our observation, our inspection, and our inquiry. So they've listed it here as a test of control, I think, because it could provide us evidence of the operating effectiveness of the control, but I think that it would be more useful to us in step 1, obtaining an understanding phase. Taking a look at the next slide and looking at some of the potential test of controls, and let's just look at one of these. Okay, the internal control is making sure the credit department has done a credit approval. Okay, and we want that to happen because our salesperson might not be so much interested in the client as much as they are making the sale. So we'd have a separate credit department that would provide that approval. And then the auditor would be looking for that credit approval on sales orders. Okay, now, why is the auditor interested in that? Well, we want to make sure that our client properly screens their customers for a credit so that they have a better chance of collecting on those receivables. And if they don't have those controls in place, the auditor would understand that there's a higher potential for there to be a misstatement. And remember, we look for misstatement in assertions. So we're now concerned that there could be a misstatement in the valuation assertion. Remember, we talked about assertions a couple chapters ago. Valuation assertion. And if that's the case, if the auditor looks and there's not a good control over the credit approval process, the auditor knows that they need to do more substantive procedure to allow us to detect a misstatement in the valuation assertion for the accounts receivable. Okay, so this is the way we do this. We make these evaluations, we then make the assessment of the risk, we then test the controls to see, and based on what we determine there, we then move always to our substantive procedures. Now, there are 2 types of substantive procedures that we could perform. One is called a test of details. The other is called analytical procedure. Okay, so there are 2 of them, test of details and analytical procedure. Now, what happens? The Auditing Standards Board realizes that you will not always be able to get a test of details when you're doing your substantive procedures, so they allow for analytical procedures. So this little rectangle over here is going to be my substantive procedures. Okay, these are my substantive procedures. This is representing my substantive procedure. And I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to color this in a little bit, do a little arts and crafts work here. So I go ahead and I'm coloring in my substantive procedures. And you can see that most of this coloring in is going in yellow here. And then I'm going to go ahead and change up the color of my highlighter, if I can do that without messing up too much here. So let's go ahead and maybe use, I don't know, what's your favorite color? How about we use purple for the top? Okay, so we use purple up here for the top. Okay, now what are they telling us here? What are we trying to accomplish by this drawing here? Well, if you look, my analytical procedures will probably be that smaller piece of my substantive testing, whereas my test of details will be the larger part, this yellow part of this drawing. Okay, now what happens? What are these analytical procedures, test of details? Test of details, we're pulling a sample of transactions. Would be a good example. Say we're pulling a sample of accounts receivable and sending out confirmations to our client's customer in help of, remember when we think about substantive procedure, we think about them in terms of our assertions to help us with the existence assertion. And we would go ahead and do that procedure as a test of details. But sometimes you have an account in which you aren't necessarily able to do a test of details. Or it could be that you believe you can get the audit evidence that you need to support your opinion just by doing an analytical procedure. So when we do an analytical procedure, we look at plausible relationships amongst financial and non-financial data. So we might compare, for example, our sales from last year to the previous year, and that could provide us some substantive evidence that our sales have not increased substantially. And that would help us as an analytical procedure, although that's more one that would be done towards the beginning of the audit, but still a plausible relationship between last year's sale and last year's sale, and that would be focusing on financial data. We could focus on non-financial data. So what are we saying there? Well, let's say you're auditing a laundromat and you want to test the washing machine revenue. And you're sitting there and you're saying, well, how can I test the details here when it's just people come up and drop coins into a machine? Well, let's say that you were realizing that and you got the city water bill, okay, and you saw that the client had used 10,000 gallons of water. They'd probably use more in a laundromat, but let's not get these numbers giant here. They had used 10,000 gallons of water. And each load of laundry uses 2 gallons. So we have 2 gallons per load. That's just 2 gallons per load. So that means that this client would have done what? 5,000 load, would have had 5,000 loads of laundry that their customers did. Okay, that's 5,000 loads. And if it's, what, $3 per load? I don't know what they charge for a load of laundry. But that means that what? That means that the washing machine revenue should be about $15,000. Now, we won't expect that it'll be exactly $15,000. But again, remember, we're looking for what? Plausible relationship. And if that turns out, based on our expectations, of what the washing machine revenue should be, this would be a good, and again, that should really happen more up here in limited circumstances where you find yourself in a situation where, again, the analytical procedure is really the only thing you can do, or if you think the analytical procedure is sufficient to give you the appropriate evidence you need to support that account, that's when you would turn to an analytical procedure. Okay, so both of these, though, are considered substantive procedures, test of details, and analytical procedure. Okay, you can also have a dual purpose test. dual purpose test is where you will, for the same transaction, do both a test of control and a substantive test. So, go back to the time cards. Let's take a look at the idea of time cards. I mentioned that a little bit before, where we're looking to see that the supervisor signed off on that. That would be a test of control. But you also might want to pick up the number of hours that the employee recorded that they worked and see that that is properly included in the payroll journal. And so we would be testing the assertion, the completeness assertion, that the employee put down the number of hours that they worked. And so we would go ahead and go from the document, the time card, to the sales journal to make sure that we have complete information, not sales journal, to the payroll journal to make sure that we have complete information about the hours that the employee worked. So it's a dual purpose test, same transaction, same time card, but we're doing both a test of control and a substantive test on that transaction. That's called a dual purpose test. Okay, hang in there, guys. We're into the home stretch now of this lecture, and we're going to finish up with a discussion of establishing materiality, okay? And what we're going to see is that we will really have two levels of materiality that we'll consider. One is going to be called overall materiality. The other is going to be called tolerable misstatement, but you're going to see that on a couple of the slides I've inserted, could also be called performance materiality. And when we look at these performance materiality, these tolerable misstatements, we not only need to consider them for the account balances and the financial statements, but also the note disclosures. Okay, so let's just go ahead and take a look in this idea of materiality, and the Supreme Court has weighed in on this. Again, remember we said a misstatement is material if it could change the decision of a potential creditor investor of the company. So we have these steps that we have these steps that we go through here, and you can see that we have our step one, our overall materiality. Step two is going to be determining our tolerable misstatement or our performance materiality. And then step three, which really we'll get into in some of the much later chapters, but we're going to actually take a little example of that here up front, but we'll do more of that in some of the later chapters when we get to the near the audit. But we have to evaluate the impact of whatever our testing told us, based on our materiality levels that we've come up with. And it's two levels, overall materiality and our tolerable misstatement / performance materiality. Tolerable misstatement is if we're referring to actually doing some sampling with that transaction. Performance materiality is if we don't use sampling for our audit procedure. Okay, so let's just go over it. Let's take a look. And just a reminder, we have to consider both the qualitative and quantitative, not necessarily in that order as I circled them, quantitative and qualitative aspects of our for our materiality. So obviously quantitative is going to be a dollar amount, and we're literally going to come up with a dollar amount for both our overall materiality and our performance / tolerable misstatement materiality. And we will also consider qualitative factors. So remember, I had given the example, if I had known that the financial statements were materially misstated because of management fraud, even though it was $25,000, I think, in the example I gave, I would have never bought the stock. Quantitative would be a larger amount, right? $25 million, I think, is what we gave in the example. But we consider both of these. Now, you come over, and this information is straight out of your textbook. I think it begins like at about page 85, okay, where I took a couple of excerpts from your textbook and put them in here so that we can read these together, okay, and I can provide a little perspective into some of your text reading. Okay, so let's just take a look. And you see here that the PCAOB guidance states that an auditor should consider company's earnings and other relevant factors when considering materiality, whereas the AICPA's Auditing Standards Board is going to consider actual benchmarks that we will use to come up with a dollar amount for our materiality. But just looking at it from a macro level, materiality is the maximum amount of misstatement that will not affect, again, it's, and I got to change the pen because that's a key phrase there so that I can underscore that, that would affect the decision of users. And I've given you examples there, right? Now, they tell us that materiality is not relative, or is not absolute, it is relative, right? And so what happens? For a small company, $5,000 might be material, but for a smaller company, For a smaller company, $5,000 might be considered material. For a larger company, not so much, right? And so it is really relative to the size of the company and the overall effects on the financial statements. Then you come over and you take a look. Again, this comes straight from your book. And remember, the AICPA said that we have to use benchmarks to come up with our materiality. And they give us some examples of different benchmarks that could be used. These are obviously financial statement line items. And then they give us some relevant percentages that could be applied to come up with our materiality. Okay, so let's just take a look. And they say, for example, 2 to 5% of income before taxes could be used for, say, public companies. But they note to us, as a common rule of thumb, in practice, you can use 5% of income taxes, income before taxes, I should say. However, if you're sitting there and you're not in a stable environment, then you may want to take some steps to normalize earnings and make steps there that we're not going to go through all that detail to come up with your benchmark. Or you may just decide, you know what, because income is fluctuating, I am not going to sit here and even use income. I'm going to use something more stable like assets, etc. So it is the auditor's decision as to what you use as a benchmark, and you would consider all the aspects and operations of the company making that determination. Going over to the next page, next slide from the text, and we say that tolerable misstatement in, and I put in performance, performance and materiality, is allocated to an account or a class of transactions. So we're going to take that overall materiality that we just came up with, and then we're going to go ahead and apply it, come up with a performance, I should say, tolerable misstatement. And so we're going to literally come up with amounts of misstatement for our account balance, of tolerable misstatement or performance materiality for our account balances, transactions, note disclosures. So you come over and you take a look at this step two, and they tell us here, and let's just read this together, the auditor should determine tolerable misstatement at amounts or amounts that reduce to an appropriately low level the probability the total of uncorrected or undetected misstatements would result in a material misstatement of the financial statements. And so two key words up there is to what we're worried about, uncorrected or undetected misstatements. Okay, so what we'll do is provide ourselves with a tolerable misstatement, and that's going to help us to establish the appropriate scope of our work now as we go forward with that. So again, the purpose of setting tolerable misstatements is to establish the scope of the audit procedures to our individual account balances, transactions, disclosures. And so we come down and we say, in practice, auditors commonly set tolerable misstatement for each account balance at 50 to 75% of overall materiality. In other words, what are we going to do? We're going to go ahead and take a smaller amount of our overall materiality and use that in testing our individual account balances. Okay, we could lower our percentage even more than that they're talking about above. For example, high risk of an account balance class of transaction or one that disclosure. For example, you could have a situation where maybe there's disclosures about the debt to equity ratio of the client and how that's affecting their compliance with a loan covenant. That might be a high risk disclosure that you might even come up with a lower materiality for. Or if there's been a lot of turnover, high risk issues going on, there could be some concern there. So you come over to the next step and you take a look at this step three, and we start to take a look at the audit evidence then is gathered, and we would aggregate our misstatements, consider the effect of the misstatements, and compare the aggregate misstatement to the overall materiality, and we're literally going to compare the performance/tolerable misstatement materiality to the individual accounts. And if the aggregate is less than the overall and we are less than our tolerable misstatement for the account balances, our performance materiality, then the auditor can determine that their financial statements are fairly stated and there is not a misstatement. Obviously, if there is a problem, then we would want some sort of adjustment for that. But let's just go over, because I know we're sort of talking about this in the abstract here. So let's just go over and let's take a look at this specific example now of our steps. And what they're doing is they're looking at the financial statements that are in Chapter 1 for this Earthware Clothiers, and that's on page 29 of your text, just after Chapter 1, I guess. They just put that in there. And what they're going to do is now take a look at the steps and actually apply them to those example financial statements. So let's just take a look. And they tell us that their income before taxes, which they pulled up from those financial statements, was $36 million. Auditor decides that that's the benchmark and will provide and will apply a percentage of 5% to that. Thus, our overall materiality, just doing the math here, 5% of the $36 million of our income before taxes is going to be $1.8 million. So we've got that. And as I mentioned, a lot of the stuff that we're looking at, you can literally see the page number there that McGraw-Hill puts in here for us. You can see that in step two, we determine the tolerable misstatement, okay? And remember, we said the tolerable misstatement will be a percentage of the overall materiality. They selected 50%. So notice we have what? We have that high level overall materiality, but we also have a performance level materiality, a tolerable misstatement. If we're using sampling, we'd call it tolerable misstatement of 900,000. So we have these levels of materiality that are lower than the overall. So the tolerable misstatement is less than the overall materiality. And we do this to make sure that we don't have errors that are undetected or uncorrected that would accumulate and exceed our overall financial statement materiality. So we set a testing materiality for our audit procedures a little lower than our overall materiality. So we're going to be gathering those numbers at two levels, one at our overall level and one at our performance/tolerable misstatement level. So you come over and you take a look, and you can see on the next page now, step three, okay, and we evaluate the audit evidence now. And they give us an example here, and we're going to take a look. Now, this is from your text. The misstatements are compared to the tolerable misstatement, and we allocate to each account. For example, the first misstatement indicates a factual misstatement in accrued payroll expenses. Factual means that we have no doubt that there's a misstatement. We looked at the transaction, we found the misstatement, we went and looked at that with management, and we determined that yes, there is that misstatement in the financial statements. That makes it factual, and it was for that particular transaction, so there was some payroll that they should have accrued that they did not. So they go ahead and they're saying, well, that's going to affect my liabilities. I'm going to have this credit to my accrued payroll, and I should have debited payroll expense. I should have debited bonuses for that. Okay, so they go ahead and they're showing that appropriate journal entry for that payroll that was not accrued. Okay, then they come over and they take a look and they're saying, well, we have this situation now where, and they notice they put the bonus, the explanation here, we're trying to accrue some payroll, okay? And then we come over and we take a look at this next one, and they tell us this next one was based on results of a statistical sample. So it's not just this one performance level materiality that we're looking at. It's also our tolerable misstatement where we would use sampling, and based on the statistical results, we have a misstatement of $312,000. And so we go ahead and we make the adjustment for that, debit the expenses, and credit our asset. We're crediting inventory. We're debiting our cost of sales. So apparently they forgot to record a cost of sales. And I'm assuming along with this, there'd be some sort of adjustment to our sales and our account receivable as well. So anyway, they go through this process. We're not worried about the adjusting journal entry so much here as we are. Now they're going to evaluate how this misstatement stacks up against our overall financial statement materiality and our tolerable misstatement. And so we take a look, and misstatement amounts of 900, in this example, no error is larger than the misstatement amount of 900,000, and total misstatement is also less than the overall materiality. Okay, now what do they tell us? Since that's the case, although we would want to still consider there's a potential of undetected misstatements, maybe misstatements that weren't corrected from the previous year that remain uncorrected, and so you would need to consider that to make sure that the aggregate misstatements do not cause the financial statements to be materially misstated. If one of the entries here were in excess of our tolerable misstatement for an account balance, or if the aggregate misstatements were greater than our overall materiality, the auditor would have asked for an adjustment to the financial statements. So when you notice the individuals, you know, none of them are more than the 900,000, right? If you just look at these individually, none of them are more than the 900,000. And then what? If you were to add all these up, and I went ahead and added those up. I'm not sure why they didn't do it here, but we can just go ahead and add all those up. And when we add them up, I came to a total here, where we want to write this, a total of $1,092,600, give or take, okay, is what I got when I added that up. And so that is not more than our overall. And our overall, you may have trouble remembering, was what, this 1.8 million. It's not, it's less than that 1.8 million. So that's why in this example, they're concluding that we do not need a adjustment to the financial statements. Okay. So that is how we would do that. Takeaways from this is what? Two levels of materiality. Overall financial statement materiality, we get that by applying a percentage to a benchmark in the financial statement. Auditor judgment as to what benchmark you select, what percentage you apply, but that gives us our overall financial statement materiality. We then go ahead and apply take a multiple of that is going to be less than my overall financial statement materiality, and I use that as my tolerable misstatement, my performance materiality. Okay, so overall materiality is larger, performance materiality / tolerable misstatement is a lower amount. And then I go ahead and I do my auditing procedures, whether they are sampling or not. And I go ahead and I do that procedure, and then I compare the misstatements to my tolerable misstatement, my performance materiality. But I'm also keeping track of how those are accumulating to that higher level potential materiality for my overall materiality level, for my total of the potential misstatements. In this case, they were fine. Now you're probably thinking, well, what would you do if they weren't fine? Well, we're going to get into that in some of the later chapters as we start seeing how these sort of tests would affect our audit opinion. Okay, that's the end of the chapter. We're going to go ahead and talk a little bit about the homework now. Okay, so I'll be back on screen here in a minute and talk to you a little bit about the homework.